Hello, my lovely anatomists and physiologists. Let's take a closer look at the capillary bed itself. So I just pulled this diagram directly out of our OpenStax textbook. Remember, the text is always linked in our video description, so that's going to be an important resource. What we're able to see here, let's start by picking out that arteriole, which remember is sort of like our smaller artery. So thinking back to our systemic circuit, we said blood leaves the heart, enters an artery, from an artery goes to the arteriole, and then flows into the capillary bed. But as we talked about the capillary bed, we did describe it as a resource allocation master. So remember what that's talking about is this ability to determine locally whether blood should flow through that capillary bed or not. Remember, we can't distribute blood equally to all of our tissues, and we don't need to. Our tissues are active at different levels. For instance, right now, this moment, making this video, I'm sitting in a chair. So my lower torso, is not very active. I'm using postural muscles in my torso, and my legs aren't doing anything. I'm using my hands to do some drawing on your presentation, and then I'm using my mouth like a whole bunch, right? And so my blood flow doesn't need to go to my legs as much as maybe to my arm, my brain, my tongue, in order to make the video, right? So for you all, you're sitting, watching the video, you're maybe hopefully taking some notes, and so you're in a similar sort of activity level as I am, right? And so what we see is that the capillary beds are gonna like locally control the flow of blood. What we'll see too is that the bed itself can consist of like 10 to 100 capillaries. So as we look at this arteriole coming in, so let's look at our diagram just a minute. As we look at our arteriole coming in, we see there is this vessel that takes you directly from the arteriole to the venule. And coming off of that vessel, which remember that vessel is described as a meta-arteriole. It's described as like a vascular shunt connecting the arteriole directly to the venule. So let's make sure we see that our venule is over here in blue. Notice coming off of that meta-arteriole, we have a bunch of different smaller vessels. Those are the capillaries. So in that connecting off of that meta-arteriole, that's where we're going to see the 10 to 100 capillaries. And notice between the meta-arteriole and the capillary, we have what's called the precapillary sphincter. And so this is really doing a localized control, right? This sphincter, this is so great, is in the off position by default. And that's what we see here. So in this picture, in this diagram, the capillaries are all looking empty. All of the color is going from the arteriole through that meta-arteriole into the venule, and nothing is happening into those capillaries. And so the precapillary sphincter is in the off position by default, right? And so another way we can say that it's going to open as needed. It's going to open as needed. So if this tissue surrounding the capillary bed has like elevated carbon dioxide gas, that means it's more metabolically active, right? And so then it's going to need some oxygen. That's going to open it. If this tissue surrounding has elevated hydrogen ion, again, that's a indicator that this tissue is metabolically active. If it's got a lower pH, if it's more acidic, it's more active. And so then the precapillary sphincter is going to open, right? Because this tissue needs that delivery, right? If we have an elevated body temperature, in this particular area. So just like a little localized increase in body temperature, that's another indicator that we have metabolically active tissues, right? So the precapillary sphincter has this ability to use like chemoreception and thermoreception as kind of a way to know whether we need some more blood flow in this particular area, or if we have low oxygen, right? It's going to be another indicator that this tissue is active. And so we're going to see it opening up. We'll see it opening up. Notice too that we have what's described down here as arteriovenosis anastomosis. Oh, that word is crazy to say, right? And this is just talking about a direct shunt. So this is a total bypass of that capillary. So we have some blood that's just totally going from the artery to the arterial to the venule. And then we have that blood flow that's going kind of through the capillary bed, which may or may not be open, right? And that's the meta-arterial. We'll see too that this movement through the capillary bed then is not like a smooth flow. So we're going to get what's described as, I'm going to write it here, vasomotion. And the vasomotion is talking about pulsating flow of blood through the capillary. And so again, this is based on what is the need for this particular capillary bed. So if you're metabolically active, like if your skeletal muscle is metabolically active, then you're going to have these features that we've listed up here. We're going to have low oxygen, high CO2. We're going to have a lot of lactic acid or hydrogen ion. We're going to have elevated body temperature. And so these precapillary sphincters will open and the blood will move into the capillary bed. If we're in our digestive tract, if we're moving around the small intestine and we get a signal that there's a lot of nutrients, then we need to increase the flow of blood to the small intestine. So we do see it's a very local. So we do see that control here is very, very localized. All right. Up next, let's talk about blood flow in more general terms, not specific to the capillary bed. And as always, take care of yourselves and each other.